Good afternoon, beloved, those who gather in person and online. We've got about 45 or so folks online in addition to those of us who are gathered here. So this is a great continuation of our Eastertide celebration as we try to live out what love and liberation actually means on the ground. So let us pray. O gracious and holy one, here we are again, continuing to stand in the glory of your presence. And we ask, O God, that you will be with us as we reflect and ponder protest at midnight, as inspired further by the sermon for this day. Help us to be your people who follow your Son, our Savior and Liberator, Jesus the Christ. Now bless this conversation that it might be glorifying to you and edifying to the people of God. It's in Christ Jesus' name we pray. Amen. So let's do this, and we invite you to continue to just be comfortable. A couple more persons will join as they bring their meals in. And for those of you who are gathering online, we wish we could have sent you a meal, but hopefully you've been refreshed if you've been in worship already. And we will be able to you can participate in the conversation via chat and during our Q&A as well. So we're excited about this option. So this panel, right, is anchored. It is anchored in a shared commitment to advance the freedom struggle for global liberation at these intersections, the intersections of race and nation and gender and class and sexuality and all of the things that would otherwise divide us. So we gather at these intersections to unpack scripture, to unpack the sermon, and to, if you have not already read Protest at Midnight, that we're hoping that this conversation will definitely inspire you to get your highlighter out and read it and ponder it, because we are, this is part of unions in collaboration with the Association of Black Seminarians and the New England Conference of the United Methodist Church and all of our partners, Boston University School of Theology, trying to elevate our voice of public witness, public theology, so that what happens here on Sunday in worship has a real and tangible connection to the protest in the streets, right? To the work that is ahead. So you don't have to have read the book in order to understand what we're doing, but we're hoping that what we do here will help us understand more deeply what Bishop Storey is working towards and for in the text and in his preaching. So let's do this. I'll introduce the panel members, one who is online, and then the other three in person with me here. But first, we want to ground ourselves in a hymn. Bishop Storey, you spoke about the ways in which, right, Christians through time eternal have sung as a way of inspiring that even the songs of freedom might loosen chains. So this meditation is one that our congregation developed at the height of the Black Lives Matter movement. Of course, you talk about it in the final chapters of your text. The Black Lives Matter movement, the movement for liberation and justice, on whose shoulders we stand. And it's set to an old hymn, Charles Tinley, "When the Storms of Life Are Raging, Stand by Us." So receive this meditation as we continue being church together.
When the storm of life is raging, Stand by me when the storm of life is raging. Stand by me when the world is tossing me like a ship upon the sea. Thou who rulest wind and water, stand by me. In the midst of tribulation, stand by me. In the midst of tribulation, stand by me. When the host of hell assail and my strength begins to fail, Thou who never lost a battle, stand by me.
God is good.
Amen.
And anything that we're experiencing pales in comparison to what George Floyd experienced for over 8 minutes as he lay on the pavement. No one was allowed to help him. No one came for him. He called for his mother, and no one helped him. So persons on the payroll assassinated him, lynched him in the street. So I'm doing fine because I'm living and breathing. But I will continue to work and march and labor and suffer until all of God's children are seen as equal, and that no person should be tried on the street like an animal.
Amen.
Black lives matter! Black lives matter! Black lives matter!
So, beloved, we gather with this as our inspiration, that the one who stands by us compels us to keep walking, to keep marching, to keep protesting. Before I turn it to the panel, I would be remiss if I did not invite our own Bishop Sudarshana Devadar to greet you, followed by Tom for a couple just brief remarks, and then we'll go to the panel.
Beloved in Christ, this is an historical day in the ministry and mission of the Union Church in Boston. This is a great day in the Boston Episcopal area. We are indeed blessed to be in the presence of a bishop, pastor, preacher, scholar, and prophet who walked the walk and who walked the talk and the call given by our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, courageously and boldly, to answer the main question: what did it mean to obey Jesus in the midst of apartheid? We all need to be inspired, challenged, and stimulated by what this great preacher preached in 1986, in the height of apartheid, when he said these powerful words: "Let me say to President Botha, apartheid is doomed. It has been condemned in the councils of God, rejected by every nation on the planet, and is no longer believed in by the people who gave it birth. Apartheid is the God that has failed. Let not one more sacred life be offered on its blood-stained altar." It was 1986. Thank God for Bishop Storey, President Nelson Mandela, Bishop Desmond Tutu, and others who enabled the apartheid to be dismantled. Today, friends, we are in 2022. We have new modern forms of apartheid that is killing our humanity in the forms of phobias, racism, sexism, and all kinds of phobias, and leaders keeping unholy silence when there is injustice all around us. And these modern apartheids are ruining the fabric of humanity. There is no salvation without humanization, where all children of God are respected, loved, and given their proper identity, because we are all created in the image of God. It is my hope and prayer that this afternoon we will be filled with courage, wisdom, grace, and power as we listen to the lead player in the panel and the members of the panel as they lead us to ask and answer the question: what does it mean to obey Jesus in our world as we dismantle the newest forms of apartheid in our society? May God be present through the power of the Holy Spirit and fill us with the love of Christ as we get into the sacred hour. Thank you.
When I retired from teaching in 2019, I decided that maybe I should go back to school and learn something. So I enrolled in something called the Living School in the Center of Action and Contemplation, created by Richard Rohr. The most important word in the Center for Action and Contemplation is the word "and," because both need each other, and both are dependent upon each other. We've got to overcome our dualisms in this world, and we've got to begin to see the whole. Action was the first mention, though. It has the priority because it's the goal. But it only works as if it's inspired and guided by the spiritual life of contemplation of our theology. Richard Rohr's, Peter Storey, you're the same thing for me, Peter Storey and Richard Rohr. Peter Storey's father said to him that discipleship begins in theology and ends in politics. And I guess the thing that I'd like to say today, and I'm going to really shorten what I had to say, is that we need to really work hard as religious people to deal with a theology that is true. And the first thing I would say is that we need to begin to talk about experiencing God, not just talking about God, not just talking about creeds and the like, but having that relationship that Jesus had with his Abba. That's important. And contemplation for me is being able to see and experience God in everybody and in everything and in every moment. The question then is, what is this God? Who is this God? Is it a God that in this world of science and religion and in our time we live in, that makes sense to us and makes sense to other people? Everything broke for me when I really began to take seriously that God is love. And Jay said this is love and liberation, love and action, contemplation and action. I think that we've got to begin to understand that everything flows from love. And we're talking about not an easy love. We're talking about the love that is unconditional, that's self-emptying, that's forgiving, that's reconciling, that is just. And it's a restorative justice, not just a retributive justice. I think that if we begin to understand that love is the foundational reality of life in which we want to experience and relate to, everything opens up. And basically, in my old age, I think I've got a better picture of the big picture. The details are kind of fuzzy now. But the big picture to me is that we've got to receive love. Remember that we were told that we love because God loved us, and we got to give love. And it's got to be that unconditional, self-emptying, forgiving, reconciling, just, restorative just justice. And to me, that's the wellspring of all of our actions. And if it doesn't come out of that wellspring, then it doesn't create the action that this world needs. That's really all I have to say.
So, beloved, we are grateful for the about 40, 50 people that are here in building, the other 50 online. As we have deeper conversation, I've invited our panelists to self-introduce and just offer a little snippet of kind of who they are, how they situate themselves in their work, how they locate themselves. And then I've got several questions about your work, about what inspires you, about how we might live out this work as inspired by protests at midnight. So as we are unfolding, if you have questions, we'll have the mic. We can pass them around. Those of you who are joining online, you might offer your questions as well, either live or in the chat. So why don't we start with Chaplain Mikhala to introduce, then we'll go to Justin, then Dr. Maia, and then we'll conclude with Reverend Professor Storey.
Good afternoon. My name is Minister Mikhala. I use the pronouns she, her, hers. And I currently work at Boston University School of Theology in the Office of Contextual Education, where I support our two co-directors in helping students discern their vocations. But my situatedness on this panel is that I was a hospital chaplain in the very beginning and middle of the COVID-19 global pandemic, which is still happening. Before that, it was 2018 where on paper I became a chaplain. And I say on paper because my becoming was called forth by my ancestors many years before that, but it was in 2018. I moved to Boston in 2016 to pursue my MDiv at Boston University School of Theology, and a month later, my dad died, and then Trump was elected, and then I attended my first protest. But it was in 2018 where I became a chaplain. And the work that I was born to do was to be a chaplain. Let's see. And as Easter teaches us, it's in our stories that death is not the ending, but just the beginning. So that was when I began to hear the stories, and I fell in love with people who had more life experience than me, who had chronic conditions that were housed and unhoused, dealing with lots of things in their lives, or just beginning their stories of love as a family. It was beautiful to witness that. I was invited into this sacred ground day after day, and it changed me. That is the piece that I'm bringing here today, that we are changed by those that we love, by the stories that we hear. They change and transform us, and I have been changed into a keeper of stories.
Amen. Thank you, Minister Mikhala, to this amazing congregation of union and community of faith, a Memphis family that's joining in. Hello, I'm calling in from Memphis. I am Justin J. Pearson. I use he, him pronouns, and I am honored to be on such a distinguished panel with Reverend Storey as well as my great friends in the church movement for justice. I am the president of Memphis Community Against Pollution, and I also serve as a strategic advisor and a leader of the Poor People's Campaign, National Call for More Revival, here in the Mid-South. When thinking about this question, and I only have 2 to 3 minutes, I think it centers on what does it mean to seek the liberated life, which we've talked about a couple of times here at Union. The fight that we were in against two multi-billion dollar corporations seeking to take Black folks' land, poison a million people's drinking water, devastate our own history for the profit of billion dollar corporations, awaken this true need to make real what we believe in this church and what I've been taught to believe about Black liberation in particular. That we must be and choose to be with those who are being most excluded and most marginalized because that social location, as we learn about, is exactly what Jesus did. And so my situation here, helping to lead an environmental justice movement, helping to talk about interlocking injustices of racism, of poverty, of ecological devastation, of a war economy, of millions of people being without healthcare, and a false moral narrative of white nationalism that we continue to come up against is deeply rooted in the hope and the belief and the possibility that we will be free one day, recognizing as our ancestors of old did, that even if you do not see it, it doesn't give you a pass to not work for it. And so this work now in this movement and intertwines quite deeply with my own personal theology, which has been nurtured and fostered by this community, a union, and been fostered by my family and my community of faith, because there is no way to win without God. And it's good news that God's on the side of those who are being oppressed. And I'm really glad to be here with y'all.
Here and online. My name is Filipe Maia. I use he, him pronouns. I'm an assistant professor of theology at Boston University School of Theology. And I'm a Methodist. And I think that might be the best way to introduce myself. I was raised by Methodist educators. I'm a fourth generation of Methodists from the Brazilian Methodist tradition. And so there was something that I learned in a space like this that made me very uncomfortable in being in a space like this. And so as I was discerning a path to ministry and to theological education, I started participating in an ecclesial-based community in my hometown in Brazil. And my ministry was playing soccer with kids. It's culturally appropriate. And so that was the beginning of my journey in a liberating type of experience of the Christian faith. And eventually, that ecclesial-based community expanded, and I was leading a Bible study group with the women in the neighborhood. This is a very impoverished and oppressed community in the slums in the outskirts of my hometown. And so the experience of reading the Bible with women who could not read, almost all of them were illiterate, and learning with them that there were women in the stories of the Bible that they heard growing up, but did not believe that could participate in that story as well, that story did not belong to them. So my experience of coming to this type of faith was the experience of learning that there is actually a central place for those who have been marginalized in the Christian story, and there is no such a thing as a Christian story without their voices being at the center. So I'm glad to be here. I'm honored to be part of this panel and to bear witness to what Reverend Storey has done, and to know that this movement of people who are checking their Jesus, that this movement is still alive and flourishing despite all the persecution that continues to rage on.
Well, Dr. J, I've said a fair bit already this morning. I will just say that the sentence which haunts me right now is, please God, show me a church that the world will take seriously. I've known moments when the world took the church very seriously indeed, so seriously that in the end the president of my country ordered that the headquarters of the South African Council of Churches should be blown up, and it was. That, you could say, is being taken seriously. Somehow the church was doing stuff that got to people like him, who thought they had all the power in the world. And there's an arch, a beautiful wooden arch at the top of the main street in Cape Town, my home city. It's called the Arch for the Arch. And it was built in tribute to the contribution of Archbishop Desmond Tutu to the liberation of South Africa. And the important thing about the arch is not just that it's beautiful, but its location. Its location is between St. George's Cathedral and the House of Parliament. And it's on the direct spot where in 1960-something a number of us were arrested. We were marching from the place where people listen for the truth of God to the place where people act as if they are God. And that's the space where the church belongs. because that's the space where the little people who God loves most suffer most. And so it's for us to take the truth of God to the people who believe they can act as if they are God, in the name of the little people who God loves most. That's the kind of church I pray for. And I'm grateful to be today in one such place where I believe earnest attempts are being made to be that kind of church, partly because of the guy next to me here. Thank you.
So look, the first question is it's a wild card. I didn't put it on our little thing, but it's kind of inspired, right, by this collective echo that I'm hearing, right, from you, Justin, Filipe, Mikhala, and of course, Reverend Storey. It's about stories, right? The being keepers of stories, learning the stories, telling the stories with those who may not be able to read but know it and feel it in these ecclesial-based communities, right? Justin, being able to write another story when a pipeline, billion-dollar corporations plan to do one thing and, right, the narrative was rewritten. So then the question is for us all, and whoever can start, is, right, so what is the story that the church should be telling that it's not telling?
I'll excitedly join before smarter people than me go, like Minister Mikhala. See, that's how you do it. I learned it. I'm not a BU superstar, but I'm learning from them. I think the story that the church should probably start telling, particularly the Christian church, is the story of Jesus. And Reverend Storey did a great job speaking about this today, but this Palestinian Jew that was 33 years old, lynched by the government, story should probably be told everywhere that we go. And it is unfortunate that it has been co-opted by people on the more conservative side of the political spectrum in our country to be really a story about a white supremacist who is intending to only keep power for white people in America and for the wealthy in our country. They've taken our Jesus, who really suffered for the little people, who died for those who were excluded and loved those who were most marginalized, who the society scorned, right? And we talked about this in Palm Sunday. He calls to a tax collector the type of people that the society doesn't like, right? Like he tells those people there is grace, there is love for widows, there's love for orphans. And I believe that the church is not screaming from the hilltops the right story, the right narrative. And it has been because of the silences coming from the church in moments of protest when we are arguing, even in Memphis, we are arguing with churches to say, choose to be on the side of folks who are fighting the corporations and not accept donations from corporations, right? We are in this type of system and a society where our churches are becoming havens for middle-class folk and havens for corporate folk and havens for people who would otherwise see harm done, rather than places that are saying the social order and the status quo is quite literally killing people. We're suffering under slow lynchings and slow violence. And the church has an opportunity, an obligation, and a responsibility to speak up and to be the voice of love and the voice of justice. And so the narrative that I want to hear more about is that Jesus boy, born in a manger. That's the one that I want to hear the church talking more about, because it in and of itself as a story is subversive to everything that this country is telling us needs to happen or should happen or would happen, right? Which is having people going on spaceships while other folks are unhoused, right? That's the narrative we currently have. But if you talk about this manger born Jesus, where God interacts with humanity, I think something changes. Minister Mikhala.
The only reason I was starting is I was just going to keep the order we were in, but thank you for starting us off. And the kind of church that I want to hear more about is where we recognize that Jesus was a Palestinian brown boy and he loved his mama. And, you know, he was a human being who loved children. And one of the reasons that I chose Union to be my church home is because we celebrate when kids join into the sermon, because they're part of the congregation. And, you know, just knowing that no matter who you are, there is a place for you in the story of God's life, and it's not an exclusive club. It's not something you could ever do to be a part of. You already belong, and that is the part that there are many people who don't want you to know, that you already belong in God's story, so.
I'll just add, I love this. Tell the story of Jesus with the reign of God that Jesus, the story of the reign of God that Jesus told, right? I think, I'm going back to check your Jesus. There are some theologians in El Salvador who always said that the church was really good at preaching Jesus, but apart from Jesus' reign of God, what Jesus preached as the reign of God, you know, where people get visitations in prison, where the sick are healed, where the poor hear good news, where debts are forgiven. So when we tell the story of Jesus, which is, I think, is our story, tell it with that society that Jesus preached that came with it, right? It's not just, you know, the individual one, but tell the story of that society that he dreamed about.
Yeah, what I hear, right, is the story we need to tell is first to preach an embodied real Jesus, right? The Jesus who is brown, grows up occupied in an occupied state, right? Who loves his mama, and to preach what Jesus preached, right? Which is the reign of God, the kingdom of God, which is near, right? Repent, turn, and do something else.
Yeah. Look, I think the story of the church has been the story of people who have been entrusted with the most revolutionary message that has ever been let loose upon the earth, and have done their very best in every generation to domesticate this Jesus and to tame this Jesus and to ensure that this Jesus did not, in fact, in any way undermine the status quo. But every now and again, he breaks through again. And I believe I've experienced a moment when he did that, and that was in my own country, where he woke up just a little part of the church who began to actually take him seriously. Because we need to know that Jesus would have died of old age. He would have been a much loved rabbi, and everybody would have wept over his funeral when he was 98 years of age, if he hadn't one day turned to face the center of power, religious, political, military power in a city called Jerusalem, and to march on that city alone and unarmed, non-violently, to challenge those powers. If he hadn't done that, he would have died of old age. And that's the one thing we try to avoid in church. We've got round to teaching people that being a Christian is being nice, and that's it. As long as you're nice. And Jesus wasn't always nice. He took on the world. And that's why I say we need a church that the world will take seriously. And if it's not taking us seriously, we're following the wrong Jesus.
Somebody ought to say amen.
Mm-hmm. Amen.
Amen.
Like, this one of the most... I mean, your sermon was so powerful today, and I'm drawn back to it again. And this the fear of like being a disregarded church, right? That, you know, we do good things, we worship nicely, right? We build buildings, we have good Bible study, we meet all the measures, but by the community, right? Completely just disregarded, set aside. So, right, if the Jesus who would have died of old age makes a turn, right, during this last week, turning towards Jerusalem, lamenting, turning over tables when he gets there, driving out. So, like, what is the rabble-rousing work, right? Like, what is the risk that the church should be taking that we're not taking, right? So, in addition to preaching the gospel, preaching what Jesus preached, what is the active praxis that makes us become outlaws?
to speak truth to power and to be unpalatable and to take risks. And church is a verb, just like love. So that means that we have to do something. So yes, we hear the stories, but then we act upon it. And what we do with those stories is the work of the church. We tell the stories, we share them, we hold them, we lift them up, and we make sure no one ever forgets.
I have one quick example of, so at the beginning of the Occupy Wall Street movement, I participated in an Advent service outside of church. It was here in Boston, just outside of the Bank of America building. And we sang, O Come, Emmanuel. And there were like four of us there. But the security guards came in and interrupted our worship experience. Because it appeared that for some reason, the God that we were expecting did not fit there at Dewey Square in front of Bank of America. So I think at that moment, I realized that I'm aligning my hopes for the coming of a different type of Messiah, right? And that Messiah was a threat to Bank of America. And there were just four of us there.
Maybe we can stay on money for a minute. Yeah. Bishop Storey, you started, right? The point number one from the sermon was follow the money, right? Pastor Nikki, you need to come on up here because we know Pastor Nikki, she's our resident preacher against capitalism, right, at Union. But like seriously, and Filipe, I know your work in economics, capitalism, and so help us. I just need somebody to say something about money because, right, my task, the pastoral team task, right, in order to preserve our place on this corner, right, we have a charge to raise probably $15 million, mm-hmm. right, given the conversion of places of worship like this into luxury condos that has seen the demise of black churches in the South End, right? Three within the last 10 years, one happened during the pandemic. So let's help me trouble that, right? I can rail against capitalism and the bills got to get paid. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Should I try? You wanna try? That's a difficult one. I remember that I think the task of justice is for us to live in just relations with each other, in just institutions. I'm quoting here. So this building needs to exist so that some form the work of justice continues to be preached in this neighborhood. And if that's the point of us raising money together, it would be not so that another church, it's not to preserve another church from being closed, but from preserving the gospel not being preached in this neighborhood, right? So I think that maintaining this big building and very non-profitable building, when surrounding us people are selling churches for the sake of profit, is an act of defiance. It is a stumbling block there, right? This is like, no, this building is not to be meant to be developed for the sake of profit. So I think the church doing that work is saying no to that big, to that push that is, in fact, certainly putting a lot of pressure on all of us, especially in a city like Boston. Yeah.
Well, I was going to just say that I'm not an economist. William Barber says that economics should be taught to all seminary students. Because it's all about money. And Jesus said more about money than he said about anything else, because he knew that that's where everything in the end seems to motivate. And unless we get real about money, unless we engage, yes, with the very people who we often criticize, And one of the things this is all I want to say, is that I notice every time I come to the United States is a terror, an absolute terror of looking like a socialist, a terror of being called not a communist, not at all, don't worry about that, just a socialist. Now, having been a Christian socialist all my life, I wonder what people are scared of about conversations about greater equity and better ways of sharing and more just ways of using the resources that God has given the earth. There is nothing sacred about preserving the right of people to become obscenely rich while a world drowns in obscene poverty. And the idea that there's some beauty and virtue about becoming a billionaire, and suddenly I must look up to you because of that. And yet you've done it in a system which also makes it impossible for most people to become just comfortable. And so that conversation must be had. The conversation about riches and poverty and good news to the poor. And we've got to wrestle with the words. You know, we talk about salvation, and 90% of the churches in this country think salvation's about going to some odd place called heaven. And it's about me. It's about getting me there, Lord, never mind the others. But the one time Jesus used that word in relation to somebody in front of him, when he said, "Today salvation has come to this house," it was when Zacchaeus said to him, "I've not been too good about money. I've been pretty dishonest, and I'm going to share it from now on." Jesus said, "That is salvation. That's what I'm about."
Justin, Poor People's Campaign, you got to say something here.
Yeah, I mean, 140 million people are poor and low income in our country. The way we measure it isn't even correct when we look at federal statistics. And the reason it is happening is because of capitalistic exploitation. We have an economic system that is entirely against our theological belief about taking care of the poor and supporting those who don't have, and uplifting instead people who already do have. And then we put people in positions of power and in government who are millionaires working at the behest of billionaires. And so we keep the systems under Democrats, under Republicans alike, the same. I hate to inform some folk, but the previous president wasn't all in all the problem. There are Democrats who are currently in positions of power, and we still have poverty at its height. We still have inflation increasing so much that people are making decisions about whether or not they're going to be able to pay for medication or food, right? Like, these are real problems that people are facing. And the thing that Mrs. Coretta Scott King said that I think we have to realize when talking about poverty, which in some academic circles even, it can only become about these numbers. She said that poverty is violence. And like, poverty is violence. The fact that people are having to give their kids less to eat or nothing to eat at all is violence enacted by those who are supposed to protect the most vulnerable, which in our case oftentimes is our government. It is the work of the church to help make Matthew 25 real. But in doing so, it isn't only for us to provide bread for those who are hungry. It's to change the systems that make it so that people don't have bread to eat in the first place, right? And we have a government, we have corporations that are extracting their wealth, squeezing the life quite literally out of people by taking their time, by taking their bodies, by doing them harm. And so you have poor folk who are in the jobs that have the most high risk, right? And then you have those same folk getting sick, and those same folk living in states and places that don't have access to healthcare. And then the wages are so low that you aren't able to afford access to healthcare. And so you go to the emergency room and you leave with a $10,000 debt. How are you, right, at $10 or $12 or $7.25, which is the minimum wage here in Tennessee, how are you to recover? You are not. And that is the design. It is designed this way. It is created this way. And what is subversive, what is the work, what we have to do. It isn't only just being anti-capitalist just because, it is being anti the violence that capitalism perpetuates in its extractive economy that says, because we want to have certain phones, we'll go to certain countries on the continent of Africa and we will destroy entire communities. Because we want chocolate, we'll be okay with slave labor of eight-year-olds in the continent of Africa and across the world for cocoa beans. Because we have these things and these wants, we'll hurt and harm people. Our current society is not able to continue to operate with all of our conveniences for us to get to salvation. It requires sacrifice. We have to sacrifice. And we have to force other people to realize that the sacrifices that have to be made are for the betterment of all of us if we're going to have a society into the future.
Echo, right? Right, it's not so much sometimes we get caught up in like the phrase, the name, like capitalism, and then we're off down a tangent, right? It's what capitalism does, right? It's not simply the church as an institution that we're trying to preserve, but like for the sake of preaching the gospel, right? When you talk about socialism, like socialism becomes this bad word, but it's right. It's really what's below the surface that we're talking about. Can we live in a just society where people have at least just enough to be comfortable, right? As you, or but you know, at best, something that's much more equitable. So it does strike me then as we think about right the sake of like doing the work for the sake of, what are the sources of courage, right? That sustain us to build institutions that matter, right? That builds a movement that resists capitalism, which, right, extracts. I want to draw together the work and, right, that which gives us the inspiration, the witness. So somebody take it away. How do we sustain the work, in other words?
Well, I would want to say I think that I've often been asked the question, where do we find the courage to be and to act and to live prophetically and faithfully? And my response has always been, I'm certainly not a courageous person, and I don't think it's about courage. It's about love. It's about whether we love passionately enough to want to see a different world, a world of justice and compassion, and of true community. Do we love the people who Jesus loved passionately enough to go out and stand for them, or march for them, or stand with them and alongside them? Do we love enough beyond our own circle? Can we catch something of the contagion of a new community, the reign of God? A place where people care for one another. I was in Australia with my wife for 2 years, and it was at that time that a lot of stuff happened in my homeland, South Africa, where it made it clear that it was going to go downhill into fascism, into totalitarianism, to become a police state. And we were under tremendous temptations. People said, stay in Australia. And I was offered a job there and all the rest. And I thought to myself, well, if I'm going to go home, I better know what I'm doing, because it's no good going home unless I have some idea what it means to be faithful to Jesus in this darkening South Africa. And I came up, was given to me in my sleep, I don't know, but 4 priorities. And that's all I think God requires of any one of us, or any church, anyone who wants to do the right thing. Tell the truth fearlessly. Bind up the broken. Go to those who are suffering and be with them. Live in a way that demonstrates what real community can be. My congregation in Joburg was a sign of God's future for South Africa. That's all we were meant to be. As long as you can be a sign of what God wants to do with the whole world, you're doing right. And finally, get with God's movement for transformation. And don't look around you and pick and choose who you're with. Get alongside those who are doing the will of the Father, no matter who they are. They can be communists, they can be atheists, they can be Muslims, they can be whoever. Those are the people who will change the world. Get with them, get alongside them. So that, tell the truth, bind up the broken, live in true community, demonstrate what true community is about by the way you live in community, and get with God's movement for transformation in the world. And that took me home, and I still believe in those four priorities. They haven't failed me. I failed them often, but they haven't failed me.
For me, it's people. So I'm fueled by the spiritual ancestors that we all share and this narrative that is so compelling and so radical. I think of Esther, who in such a time as this, she was called. And I think, I did not sign up to work in a global pandemic in healthcare, but here I am. And you talk about systems that are unjust, and healthcare is probably the closest you can get, especially in America. And I think how they treat people like machines, but I'm not a car, and I'm not coming here to get an oil change. And especially in these fancy hospitals we have in Boston, they are world class. You have to be very, very sick to enter. So the thing that sustains me in that type of atmosphere is the wonderful people I got to work with. So not only the nurses, who are superheroes, by the way, but also the doctors who use their big brains, but also their big hearts every day, but also my patients. I mean, their stories, it just shows you the endurance and the compelling nature of the resilience of the human spirit. You see a virus that is taking the very breath out of people's bodies, but their spirits, even after life, you would hear things from their families where you're just like, there's nothing about this that couldn't sustain me through the night or through this day. And those are the kinds of things that keep you going. The central verse that is fueling my ministry is in Acts 3, where the name of Jesus causes a man to dance, leap, and praise God. And it's less about what happens in his body, but it's the fact that Jesus is not even in the story. It's that they use his name, and that changes what happens for this outcome. And you see someone who is completely transformed. So that's how the stories have transformed and sustained and fueled me.
I believe in the communion of the saints. I'm going to go with the Apostles' Creed. There's something in this cloud of witnesses that precedes me that will not let me go of the struggle. So I think that's so I want to answer that question by saying that there must be some type of spirituality that we must have and nurture in the work of justice. Otherwise, we expect to win all the time. And in the work of justice, we more often than not lose. And how do you preserve, your commitment to liberation when you don't win? Because that's normally the case. So I think that spirituality tells me all the time, that spirituality of liberation tells me all the time that I'm not here to win, but I'm here to be witness, to bear witness to justice. So I always, when I feel discouraged, I go to the sources, to the deep wells that I believe I have in the story of our faith, where those ancestors in the faith keep calling out and demanding that I do not give up.
We're not here to win. We're here to bear witness. That's all right. Listen, we've got time for about one or two in the room before we offer a sending forth in the Zoom room or in person. And I see there's professors, there's activists, so somebody better say something. All right, let's, yes. Come on, Bruce. Yeah, let me grab you a mic here.
I want to thank you all, the panel. A member of the union, long time serving. Could you help demystify some of the parables that we as parishioners need to understand, not only the story, but the sidebar, using an example of the loaves and the fishes. And we talk about how we support the broader picture. The story, part of the story that was untold or misunderstood is that it wasn't the number, it was the beginning of the collection and That's the good. Collaborative of the community that fed the masses. And I don't think that we see those broader edges sometimes, and that's what kind of leaves us as parishioners to short, because we don't understand the fullness of the stories.
So sometimes, to help demystify, how do we demystify the story so that it's just not a fable, a fiction, right? Oh yeah, sure, but anybody answer it as you, yeah, give it. And Ibrahim, come on up front, just so the camera can get you. But we'll hear a response first from Mikhala.
The first answer that came to mind is, I try to think of what is happening in this story with real people, and what is God trying to tell us about these real people? Because whatever God is telling us about these real people on page, God is still speaking, and that is still happening today. So I think of the story of abundance that you referenced. And what I hear in that story, the message of justice and liberation, is that God wants us to live abundant lives, and God will provide abundant good things for us and feed those who are hungry. And, you know, we don't have clear instructions in that verse specifically how, and, you know, the 1, 2, 3 of it all, but we know that that is the desire. And just finding the hope of, what does this say about God and people and the desire.
And Justin, I see that you unmuted. Did you want to jump in?
Yeah, the one thing I say to Bruce, to everybody, which I love and appreciate about this church, right, is that we can write in the margins. I believe that was a Reverend Ashley sermon from a ways back, but that if you look at the Bible, physical copy, you have space to write in the margins, and the work might not be to have the interpretation that folks on this amazing panel can give. But Bruce, I think your interpretation is gospel too. And I think we want, and folks should feel the opportunity to write in the margin and to share the testimony of the gospel as they see it and as they experience it. As Minister Mikhala said, it is living and God is still speaking and God still chooses human beings to work with and through. And so we have an opportunity to speak the vision that we experience and share that with other people too.
Professor Sundiata.
Okay. You guys really made me think, and something Jay said about churches, you know, going to condos, and I was going to globalize this. How do we have global empathy when we have global capitalism? So I work with the world's worst country, according to most political scientists, that you've never heard of. Most people never heard of it. And it has per capita income in Africa of maybe $36,000 per year, which for Africa is good. Most people live on $2 a day. That's why it's the worst. But it pumps out natural gas and petroleum. It has Exxon, it has Mobil, etc. Now, it's been criticized by church groups and others for the last 40 years. But those companies now give money to institutions, and black institutions in this country, sort of saying, look, we're nice guys. We publish nice books, which are multicultural. We'll give you money if you want it. Just leave us alone. Now, someone like Wole Soyinka, the Nigerian Nobel Prize winner, has said, this is phony baloney. And has really attacked a lot of people. I haven't. But it seems to me that what he's saying is we have to have global empathy. If people in this particular country, which either people say, I've never heard of it, most people go, never heard of it, I know people have heard of it and go, oh, that place. And they either, they sort of are snarky, oh, that place is without hope. There was a best-selling book on it called Tropical Gangsters, New York Times bestseller. That's the only time anyone ever heard of it. So my question is, how do we not get seduced when someone, let's say Exxon says, you know, we can help you with your building, we can help you with the schools, we can help you, just shut up about this place which has less than 1 million people and no one ever heard of. It's in a science fiction novel and it doesn't exist. So how do we get this kind of global empathy if I come to you and say, as church people, people of the church, the body of Christ, how do we not be seduced by mammon when it has a brown face, a black face, you know, a South Asian face?
Yeah. So maybe global empathy in the face of global capitalism. Felipe, Peter, if you could.
Go for it. No, you go. No, you go. You go. You have more to say about this one.
Yeah. I don't know the answer at all to many of these questions, but I do know that I will never find a way of handling that kind of question unless I locate with the poor. I'm a Methodist, and I'm amazed, and I stand in awe and wonder that a starchy high church Anglican by the name of John Wesley became a social prophet whose preaching and example transformed a very, very ugly society called England at the time. And I know that the part of it is that his heart was strangely warmed. But long before that, the real start of it all was that he located himself with the poor. And as a result, he began to see things through different eyes. And I remember Jesus with the blind man, and I remember touching him. Jesus touches the blind man, and he says, now, can you see? And the blind man says, yes, I can see people. They look like trees walking. And Jesus says, I better touch you again. Most of us have been touched by Jesus, but most of us are still looking at other people as if they're just walking trees. But Jesus wants to touch us twice, and to ensure us that we begin to see what people, who people really are. And so I think the first step for any church community or any human being says, I want to be more faithful in following Jesus. And I'm not sure about all this stuff, this capitalist stuff. And I know these oil companies, they sound bad to me, but I'm not sure where to get in and touch them. Start with the poor. Go and locate with the poor. Find people who live in poverty and try and listen to them. And they will begin to tell you the answers to the questions that people on intellectual panels find a bit of trouble answering.
Listen, Justin, I see you over there. I almost, I wish Plummet, our director of music, was still here because the preacher has got his second win. that was all right. Come on, let's bless God.
Preach! Preach! No, I'm in need of a second touch. That's all I got to say.
Bishop Devidar, please.
Professor, you mentioned about liberation theology, and liberation theology was originated in 1970, which really invited people of all faiths to be a part of the movement. And then when we look at the fight against apartheid, it was the people's movement. People from other faiths joined the church too. And my Jesus says his ministry was about extending the reign of God, a theocentric theology. And the only prayer he taught us, to us, can be said by a Hindu, as a Muslim, and a Buddhist, because this is the only prayer that we use without using the name Christ. But my question to you, Bishop Storey, how can we as Christians today bring together the people of other faiths to fight against the modern day apartheids? so that it can be God's moment.
Oh my goodness, that is so important. It's such an important question. We Christians really do think we're the only people on the block, and we're not. Just as I used to think God was a Methodist once until I discovered the ecumenical movement. And then I thought that God was a Christian until I discovered the interfaith movement. Look, the job is too big for any of us to think we've got all the answers. We need to seek out, and I guess it starts with repentance. It starts with saying that, you know, we really did think we were the only people on the block. And we really did think we had the only truth. And now we've got to, now we want to listen. And we want to take hands with people who before we somehow looked down on. And I can only say that the richest years of my life were years when I was placed in the company of saints, some of them very secular saints. I think I'm the only Christian bishop who's been invited to say a prayer in the headquarters of the Communist Party when their leader was assassinated. And they called me and said, Bishop, could you come and meet with our top people? We're all feeling very broken and we don't know what to do because we've forgotten the language that you speak. Could you come and speak it among us? And what a beautiful moment. And to realize that these are just people whose hearts break and who feel pain. You don't label them with ideological labels. And so I just think we need to reach out our hands humbly and take the riches that come from every faith and from no faith. There are people out there who want to see a new world. Let's join them.
Amen, amen. Let's do this. We're going to conclude with a song after this, which is from Easter 2021, but I think it is appropriate for us as we continue to be sustained for the work that is ahead. And there's a line that says, right, there will be glory after this, right? And you could, there'll be justice, there'll be freedom, there'll be equity after this moment that we are pursuing. But let's give the panel each just kind of final thoughts. We'll begin with Mikhala, then go to Justin, then Filipe, and then the last word goes to Bishop Storey. Amen?
I just wanted to first say thank you. It's been such a pleasure to meet with you and to be here with everyone. I guess I'll just conclude with that we really are called to do great things with little love. So if we wake up and know that we are already embedded with all of the things we need to answer the call, then we're already halfway there.
Amen. Thank you, Bishop Storey. Thank you to this amazing panel, Union, Community of Faith, Family, for the opportunity to be here, to witness and to be a part of this. I believe and have been reading a lot about bell hooks and the development of a love ethic. And I do believe that by operating and developing a love ethic, that we will be able to tear down the walls and the towers that continue to propagate the oppression of people, and that each of us, particularly those who have faith, or even as Bishop said, may have no faith, but do have a vision of a different world, have a vision of a different way that we might be able to be together, that there is something that we can do when we organize and galvanize and when we build together. And it is the infinite hope that vision is possible, that sustains me and that I hope will continue to sustain each and every one of us, because it is, as our ancestors from slave fields and from cotton fields and rice fields in this country and around the Western Hemisphere persevered in order to create something new in the future that many of us currently have. I believe that we can create something new for those who will come into the future as well, with God's help and with each other in the fight. So really grateful to you, and thank you.
I just want to thank all of you for being here, and Bishop Storey for you, your testimony. And I'll remember and remind everybody and encourage everybody to read the book. I'm a teacher, so I'm always telling people, read the book. So here's a book for you to read. Please read the book. It's just wonderful, and it's a privilege to be able to bear witness to this. At the end of the book, you will see that we move from South Africa to the United States. And there are some important words being said in those final chapters in this book. But the final thing that I'll say is, I have, over the past years, the toughest challenge for me is not the dialogue with people who are from different faiths. It has been the toughest thing for me to dialogue with fellow Christians. And my home country, Brazil, has now been for the past 4 years under a neo-fascist regime. And the church voted massively for this person, who now occupies the presidency there. And it was a kind of a repeat of 2016 here in the United States. We had it in 2018. And I still haven't found a way to talk to fellow Christians who committed themselves to such an idolatrous form of interpreting their faiths. So I think the work of the church is oftentimes to preach to itself, to challenge us, to actually be serious about the God that we profess to believe in and follow. And so this is why I'm so grateful for this panel, for this church, because we're bearing witness to a different motive of being church together in the power of the Spirit.
Bishop Storey, if I could just jump in before to echo Dr. Maia, yes, y'all, read the book. I mean, there is this, especially in light of these last two questions around like a global witness that is interfaith that Bishop Devidar mentioned, and like global empathy, the way that Bishop Storey describes, right, the resurgence of right-wing populism in our divided America as a refracturing of our common humanity. And that is a new form of global apartheid, right? So like the way in which out of his own story, right, he tells a story of his ministry, his witness, but then drives it home to say that yes, what has happened then is scarily happening now. And if we don't learn from what was experienced, then the risk might be too great. So yes, Dr. Maia, read the book.
Thank you for that word, Jay. If I can be just very, very personal, you've helped in my healing today, because you see, I come from a country which had this one bright and shining moment when we actually came together in reconciliation and justice. And when the world looked at us and said, well, if they can do it, maybe we can. And then we fell into the hands of thieves. And that beautiful and wonderful country is now wrecked and torn and broken. And so the story I used to be able to tell of what God has done amongst us has been undone so quickly and easily by a ruthless and greedy president with his henchmen. But today I've realized that, you know, the story has many chapters, and we were privileged to see that moment, and maybe that moment has sort of embedded itself in the minds and hearts of people across the world. Jesus, after his resurrection, said one thing that always fascinated me. He said to the woman, go and tell the disciples that I'm going before them into Galilee. And that's where it all began. And maybe Jesus was saying after his resurrection, it begins all over again. This battle never ends. I'll meet you in Galilee. And let's do it again. Thank you.
Put your hands together. So receive this closing blessing by song. There will be glory after this. God will turn it around, and we are the ones to do the turning. Be blessed. Go in peace. Receive this music.
Be
FCC and union. Be blessed.